the latest in conservation and turkey hunting updates. This is Fire Breaks and Flydowns.
My name is Matt DiBona. I'm the district biologist for the 6th New England state region in the Northeast. This time of year, we're wrapping up a lot of our winter and early spring habitat work. We typically do resetting some of these forest openings, right? Forest openings are an important component on the heavily forested landscape of New England. It adds a lot of structural diversity to the larger forest landscape, and typically is an area where turkeys and other wildlife will go to forage or loaf, or certainly as we move into turkey season, right? These are great places to find turkeys, strutting and displaying. So we just wrapped up a small opening project on the Green Mountain National Forest and got some additional work planned for later this year that we couldn't get to just because, as with most of New England, it was a fairly mild winter. And oftentimes when we're doing that winter forestry work, we're counting on getting that hard freeze to get in there and get on ground and minimize our impacts on these areas. The other big thing we do this time of year is apple tree management. Late February and into March is typically the best time of year for us to do that work before we enter into the spring bud break, but we've gotten through the worst of the winter. It's a great time for landowners and especially our NWTF volunteers to get out there and have a hand in improving public lands management. So we've had a few events this year. One was a technical assistance workshop for private landowners where they learned how to release and prune apple trees on their property. One of the neat things about New England is today it's a forested landscape. 150 years ago, there was a tremendous amount of agriculture. And so there are all these remnant orchards that kind of dot the landscapes interspersed amongst the stone walls and stuff. And so it's not uncommon to walk through a forest that has what was probably once an apple orchard in it. And many landowners on their property still have a handful of apple trees on their property that they've either inherited or planted. And they want to know how to manage them. And so we show them how to prune them and direct them. Our goals are not to create, orchard quality trees. We just want to increase the health and vigor of these trees so that, whether they're, 10 years old or 80 years old, they're still producing fruit that's incredibly valuable to our wildlife, especially during these fall and winter months. And so in addition to workshops to help landowners do it, we also typically host a couple conservation work days for our volunteers where they can get out there and get their hands dirty and improve, habitat on their public lands. Most of our flocks are still in winter groups. Most of the time I'm driving around, I'm still seeing birds in groups of, 20, 30, 40 birds. I think we had an overall mild winter, and so maybe you weren't, if you live in this area, you weren't seeing as many turkeys as you normally did. And I think that was because, one, there was less overall snow depth, that was kind of maybe pushing these birds out into fields. And the other thing was there was a lot of mass production this year in some areas. And so I don't think the birds had as many reasons to be out and about. And certainly, I think in a couple instances, maybe we were starting to see some birds break up a little bit. I'd see a couple birds fanned out and strutting and stuff when I was driving around lately. But, when we get those kind of big storm events in the northern New England states, that kind of puts that on hold for a little bit. Now, I know that things are going to warm up. We'll I think, be in the 50s later this week. So we're going to see a lot of that snow start to melt off in southern New England. I think flocks are maybe starting to break up a little bit, but most of them, I think, are still in winter groups. So I think a lot's going to start to happen in the next few months. And, this is still a great time to start your scouting a little bit just to find out where those winter flocks are and maybe start to bone up on your turkey calling.
Hello, my name is Chuck Carpenter, and I serve as a district biologist overseeing Arizona, New Mexico, Utah, and Idaho. In our region, we engage extensively with forest service initiatives, primarily through stewardship projects. However, due to winter and the lingering snow conditions, And the wet spring, our stewardship projects in mountainous areas are currently inaccessible. And we are in the midst of spring breakup, which is the period where industry operations are paused until the ground has dried sufficiently that machinery can operate safely and without damaging the soil. So currently we are doing some controlled burns in the vicinity of our Provo, Utah stewardship. However, there is limited prescribed fire activity across the West right now due to challenges related to access and compliance with air quality standards. Winter inversions in the West constrain burn windows for prescribed fires, and they kind of impact our ability to carry out these management practices during winter periods. So while precipitation rates differ across my states, you know, Arizona, New Mexico, all the way to the Canadian border, most of it, Utah, Arizona, New Mexico, and southern Idaho are experiencing higher than average snowpack. Conversely, northern Idaho is facing drought conditions, and in February, they've seen above average temperatures. So with these conditions, turkeys really are starting to disperse from their winter mega flocks. They're breaking up into smaller groups. Toms and Jakes are establishing their hierarchies. They are strutting. They're following the hens around, although the hens seem largely indifferent. Toms are finding themselves in sort of a limbo, displaying their prowess while receiving little acknowledgement from hens. Gobbling activity has increased significantly over the past few weeks, but it's often interrupted and totally shut down by some of these cold fronts we're experiencing, especially the one that just moved through southern Utah and northern Arizona. So with hunting season in all of my states not starting for another couple weeks, I really suggest that folks go out, they scout for birds, but it's essential to remember and realize that the birds they find now are not going to be in the areas come the beginning of the season. Most of these birds are going to move up in elevation and follow that snow line and feed on freshly emerging green vegetation. A big thing that I would hit on is similar to last year, access in a lot of areas may pose a huge challenge due to roads being inaccessible because of snowpack or muddy conditions. And always keep in mind that the roads that you drive up in the morning, they're frozen, and under the cover of darkness, you can travel on them just fine. But that might not be the case when you depart for the day after your hunt ends. So just keep that in mind. Bring your shovels and a tow strap. Good luck.
The way that the U.S. Forest Service and probably a lot of our public land managers have addressed prescribed burning is to do it, you know, more of a probably at a landscape scale. Yeah, for a variety of reasons. I mean, that's kind of historically how it used to occur. And it's also economically probably the most effective way to do it. So the way the Forest Service typically does burning is they will basically do aerial ignitions from helicopters. And they've got these, basically these spheres that are called dragon eggs. And you basically, it's a machine that injects, it's like a ping pong ball with a chemical. And then that ping pong ball is launched out and they can adjust fire behavior based upon the pattern that they drop these spheres at. And there's a chemical reaction that occurs in the sphere that ignites that, basically that ping pong ball, that dragon egg, into flames. And then they're burning thousands of acres versus, you know, a handful. So that's how some of these, actually the Mark Twain in Missouri has achieved they're actually in a good position, they have a good problem to have. They're basically have hit their cap where they're burning 67,000 acres a year. And when you got 1.6 million acres, that's kind of the scale you need to be doing it at. And the Shawnee's not burning quite that many acres, but again, they're burning tens of thousands versus a handful. And if you're going to do a rotational burn to maintain savannas and open woodlands, that's kind of the fire frequency you need to be hitting. You know, if you're burning the area every 2, 3, 4 years and you've got 200,000 acres to burn, you know, you gotta burn a bunch of it at once annually. If it needs burning, you're not going to probably be impacting all that many turkeys anyway, because if it needs burning, that's not very good habitat. So, and you're going to stop him. That's what we commonly address. Folks that are, you know, either their favorite turkey hunting spot is black when they get there, or they find a turkey nest that's been, you know, burned up, and, you know, that stuff happens. And I would say that the short-term loss is worth the long-term gain, because if you, you know, burn windows being what they are, conditions impacting the ability to burn, you know, if the more years you miss the window, the harder it is to get it back to where it needs to be, and the less likely it is to be used by turkeys. And that's kind of what we're facing with the turkey decline. There's less and less of that special kind of habitat that needs to be out there for turkeys to successfully nest and raise a brood. So I had basically one of my local committee members on my local chapter sent me some trail cam pics, and he was asking me questions about, you know, how long does it take after a hen is bred before she starts nesting. And it's, you know, because he had trail cam pictures of a hen being bred last weekend. And yeah, we're on track for normal. A lot of people think that, you know, if we get these really early warm periods of, you know, where we're in the 70s and 80s and everything's starting to bloom and pop, that boy, you know, the turkey thing's going to be over before the season gets here. And the primary driver of the reproductive season is photo period, and that does not change from one year to the next. That is what's, you know, what's causing the hormonal response to bring on the onset of the breeding season. So it can be a little later, because the secondary driver is basically the hen has to hit a certain protein threshold in her diet, because egg development process is very protein demanding. So if you get a delayed spring here in the Midwest, where that's common, if winter won't release its grip, you know, your spring greenup, which is driving that, you know, basically making those protein, you know, rich foods available to the hen, if those things aren't available, you know, you can have a delay of 2-3 weeks sometimes. So, you know, it can be later than normal, but it can't really be earlier than a certain point, because the primary driver is photo period. So we're right on track. You know, season here in Missouri opens, and it's always the third Monday in April. And that's based on 10 years of telemetry research data that says that's when peak incubation initiation occurs. So we're right on track.
So I'm Doug Little. I am the NWTF's Director of Conservation Operations for our eastern region, and I am based out of the Catskills in New York State. And although our turkey season is still a little bit away, we are neck deep in some conservation work and just keeping tabs on what's going on with the birds in the area, in the areas that I've been recently. So I figured I'd jump in and, you know, give an update on what's happening. And specifically, a couple weeks ago in New York, which again, I know we're a few weeks away from our season, we had a decent warm spell, and I'm in the Catskill Mountains, kind of a higher elevation, relatively speaking. And birds that were in winter flocks for the last few months, just kind of like we would, right? We start getting excited about spring. I think they broke up a little bit. They started doing their thing where you start, you know, the hunters like myself, we get a little antsy about the season coming up. Heard some birds gobbling for a few days in a row as the weather broke and got really warm. Birds were scattered all around, just listening on the road. They were gobbling really good. And then even by day 3 or 4 of that warm spell, they were dispersed pretty good. I was hearing birds in different spots, you know, up and down the road. So that was pretty cool. But then weather, I went to Pennsylvania for a few days and connected with a couple of staff there for some cool work that I'll talk about. But by the time I got back, and literally within about 10 minutes of me getting back, I couldn't see 40 yards out of my window because the snow was coming down. So as quickly as they got antsy and broke up a little bit, they are right back into winter mode last few days with the weather that we've had. So it's that annual thing where you start to, you know, feel like spring is coming, and then you get that dose of reality. And then you got to wait a little more. So that's where we're at this point in New York, at least in my area, the Catskills. But last week had a really cool experience visiting with David Gladkowski on our communications team and Mitch Blake, our district biologist in Pennsylvania, where we started off early in the week visiting Letterkenny Army Depot for an event that was geared towards releasing wild bobwhite quail at the Letterkenny Army Depot. That's been in the works for a while. We had been involved in some habitat work there that was going to benefit a whole variety of species, obviously, including wild turkeys. But that habitat work that was done kind of set the table for those quail to be released. And that was in the makings with the Pennsylvania Game Commission and a bunch of other partners for quite a while. And while our role in that was tied to that habitat work, there were plenty of partners that were engaged on the bobwhite quail release side. So that was cool. And then the next morning we woke up and hit the turkey blind trying to trap some birds for their gobbler, the Pennsylvania Game Commission's gobbler banding research. And that's designed to help them get a better gauge on harvest rates in Pennsylvania. So really good gobbling activity in the morning before fly down. We were right on them. The bait site was really close to where they were roosting and they were gobbling really good. A lot of hen chatter. Jakes were trying to gobble. It was kind of fun to listen to. And the birds, flew down and they stayed vocal pretty good up until the point where they got on the bait and that net fired over all seven birds. And we caught all seven that were on the bait whenever Mitch fired the rocket net. So seven for seven, six jakes, one long beard. They all received some jewelry, leg bands, and that's going to help the agency with their harvest rate estimates. And it was just a really cool opportunity and experience to be a part of that in South Central Pennsylvania.
And the update from Cully McCurdy, who covers Virginia, West Virginia, and North Carolina. Burn windows for prescribed fire application have been scarcer this year due to high winds and low humidities. However, the winds have dried soils in many project areas, allowing large equipment work earlier in the spring. Personal observations and reports from numerous hunters indicate birds are missing from fields where they normally always display by this time in early spring. However, early gobbling in these same areas proves the birds are there. Expect the unexpected.